And today we are, through an accident of our original performer, who was going to play harpsichords today, having COVID, I'm very, very lucky at the house in having some wonderful friends who I could just send an email to saying, oh, somebody can't do it, do you think you might be able to step in the day after tomorrow? Yes, says Ralitsa. So anyway, so we're very, very grateful indeed to Ralitsa for taking over. And in the last few days also, I heard of the passing away and demise of Richard Burnett. And Richard Burnett is a name that some of you might know. You might know the name Finchcocks more. It is thanks to Richard Burnett's efforts at Finchcocks from the 1970s onwards that a whole generation, couple of generations actually, of musicians have had the enormous privilege of being introduced to original instruments. And that, of course, is the inspiration that caused me to progress concerts here on, you know, ordinary pianos into, hang on, let's look at tuning. That was my inspiration, but let's look at the tuning on original instruments, see how that affects how we perform the music. And this is so important because you get students out of musical colleges nowadays who play Steinways, and they play Steinways. They haven't any idea of singing, and I'm ceasing to be able to go to many concerts because the pianists coming out of college are so awful. And when you hear that they've won such and such a music prize, well, that means they're probably even worse because the prizes are given to And you know, there's a college in Italy that tells their students that you can't play this unless you break the strings.
What?
Yes, is that music? And I'm sorry, that is the fashion. And I call it machine gun playing. Music is not that. Music is not taking the white black splodges on the white pages and putting those splodges temporarily into time. Technique. It's all technique. No. And as a result, I heard Tom Service on Music Matters the other day talking about the artificiality of music and all those jingles that we hear with adverts and so on. They've been produced on computer. They've been played 50 times and the best half seconds of each has been slotted in to make a concoction. It's not music. And live music isn't generally recorded because live musicians, unless they're top of the game, musicians who are top of their game will approach something new because they can adapt to it. It's only musicians who are half-baked who say, ooh, that's not a proper piano, no, I'm not interested in that. Oh, that tuning, oh, I've never heard of that before, no, I'm not interested in that. I only want to play a Steinway tune by a Steinway tuner. It's only the bad musicians.
This is true.
It's true, absolutely. And so it's thanks to inspiration that comes out of Richard Burnett's inspiration at Finchcocks, going back to the old instruments. And once more, you can't play these old instruments without technical faults, because some of the notes aren't going to play as you expect them to play. Welcome to making music in the instant, not constructed by computer. And so this is very, very much the inspiration of Dick Burnett. Katrina still manages a part of the collection in Tunbridge Wells, and school visits go to Frank Road in Tunbridge Wells, and she's continuing there. And we hope that by bringing on tuning here with these wonderful instruments, inspiration will happen. Now, these instruments are really fascinating. This is a Stodart of 1802, and it was in the Finchcocks collection. And of all of the instruments at Finchcocks, this was the piano that was closest to the harpsichord. And the harpsichord over there is very much the same shape. And that was copied in 1970 from a Dulcan made in 1740. So the original pianos were very close to harpsichords. Now we know I was watching a YouTube video, as one does, and suddenly my ears pricked up to an instrument that sounded like the Stodart. It was made by Longman and Broderick in London, and it was taken to Vienna by Haydn, and Beethoven played it. So the exciting thing is that that instrument sounds very close to this wonderful instrument here, and Ralitsa today is going to play Beethoven and Chopin, hearing it on an instrument that Beethoven would have, the sort of instrument that Beethoven would played. And the Emerich Betsy over here is a fascinating instrument. It was made in Vienna in 1854, and this instrument was the instrument that was copied by Stryker. And Stryker was Brahms's favourite piano, but Finchcocks had a Stryker and it had felt hammers. This has leather hammers. Now, pianos with leather hammers are technically fortepianos, and pianos with felt hammers were the emergence into the piano as such. So I like to think of this as being one of the last fortepianos, and this has amazing power. And so everybody says, well, Beethoven was really frustrated because pianos didn't have enough power. Well, I think that this would have been the fortepiano that Beethoven would wish he'd have had. Ah, and here it is at Hammerwood. It was given to us by a lady who had cancer and knew it was very special. It started off in Vienna, it went to Italy, and I think it did a stint in Egypt before coming back with the family to Forest Row. And June Cratemore from Forest Row gave it to us about 20 years ago. And the strings were original and rusty and whatever. And this is also a tribute to Michael Gamble, who's been a friend for many years, who was head of keyboard maintenance at Glyndebourne for 20 years. And it was he who restrung this and has helped us with historic instruments. Without his help, I would not have been able to take on historic instruments here. And so this concert I can't think of the right word.
Celebration,
something like that. Yes, to all sorts of people who have given inspiration over very many years, and Ralitsa is the embodiment of the product of that inspiration. And I say to her, "Well, Ralitsa, can we try this?" And she says, "Yes, no problem. Can we try that? No problem. Oh no, this one hasn't got enough notes." So I say, "Well, just forget about the odd notes. You'll just have to do them." "Oh, no. Anyway, she'll see what she can do. It's under protest, but she's great game for anything. And so, Ralitsa, thank you so much indeed.
Stodart, and then to see how that has developed over time onto a bigger instrument. So, yes, I wish you a wonderful time. Hope you can enjoy it.
And of course, Richard Burnett would have loved this sort of concert. Mm. This is just what he was. Yeah. So, can we have some large chords?
Yeah.
Thank you. The other aspect of these instruments, sorry to interrupt you, is that the historic tuning can be, in many ways, people just think, oh, well, it's a little bit of a luxury, whatever. But the thing is, that the historic tunings were based upon the harmonic series and the importance of getting notes on the scale to tune with the natural harmonics of the bass strings means that you can achieve resonance, which therefore means that what resonates, what doesn't, disappears. This opens up a completely, as far as we're concerned from the modern piano, a completely new style of playing. Chopin practiced on an instrument called a pantalon, which did not have dampers. The only way the notes were not confused was through the tuning. The dampers on this are extremely inefficient at best, and so it opens up a new dimension of playing where the volume of sound doesn't come through bashing the keyboard as breaking the strings does, taught by modern music colleges on Steinways. It comes through the sustained pedal, allowing the vibrations to emerge out of the instrument to build. So I wonder if we're going to hear that. Really difficult. And thank you, Ralitsa, for doing it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
request from this gentleman to hear the middle section of the funeral march. There is one thing that is quite important for me. It's the whole middle section. I find that one can only perceive having heard the first section. I do not intend to play the whole thing because it's a very long and heavy piece to not only to play but to listen to as well. But I'm more inclined to play just the last phrase of the first part. So that would actually lead to a completely different, for me, revelation and a different section of the piece, if that makes sense. Or I'll try.
However, this is probably a good reason to actually do some recordings on these instruments, and I think the Stodart in particular as an academic exercise. And if anybody considers that this sort of work is valuable, it would be amazing to sponsor an artist such as Ralitsa to do a recording of the whole of that on the Stodart, and indeed properly on both instruments. And I'm really wanting to work with I don't know if you felt that the tuning on the Stodart, it wasn't just the piano, it's the tuning that made that movement sound bitter. And I don't know if you got that bitter sort of taste as a result of the sound that it was making, because this is actually a stronger tuning than the Betsy. And this is B-flat minor. And it was this piece that alerted me to... I was talking to a very famous pianist recently, and I was talking about tuning. He said, well, Chopin was arranging things so it was easier for the fingers. Not quite, because B-flat minor has a particular effect, and he chose B-flat minor specifically for the second sonata. And this has a stronger unequal temperament than that, so B-flat minor. A bit narrow. This is the normal sort of tuning, because I would tune any Steinway to, or the Beethoven or whatever, and it's slightly gentler. That is earlier, and because of the structural fault, I can't get the pitch up. And to correct that structural fault will be expensive, and I don't know how to do it. I'm not entirely competent myself. I need somebody with experience. But here's B-flat minor here. And so this is not a nice key. This is deliberately very different from... This is why tuning is important, and the subject has been neglected. And so I'm wanting to work with artists who are willing to record the whole of the Bach well-tempered clavier in mean tone on the piano in the other room, on this and on that, or the Bechstein, the whole of the Mozart sonatas in mean tone. But they are amazing. Mozart cries. Now, Chopin shouldn't be played in mean tone. I'd like to hear what that mean tone does to this. But even this, strong tuning, I think has an effect on what we heard this afternoon. I would like to be working with an artist with knowing the Schubert Lieder, because I'm quite sure certain words accorded with chords which gave emotional effect. Chopin's 24 preludes, I've recorded on that sort of tuning, and I can't hear it properly. It doesn't make enough difference to me. I'd like to hear that, the 24 preludes on this sort of tuning, if not mean tone as well.
You haven't named the tunings. Is this Kellner and this is...
So that's Kellner and this is Kirnberger 3. Which has a little bit of the twist of mean tone still. I'd like to be recording the Debussy 24 preludes and Shostakovich as well. Sure. This is quite a major recording programme, and we've got to fund musicians to actually do it. But academically, I think that this is really, really big news. And so perhaps this might be inspirational. And whilst Richard Burnett started off with, oh, let's use original instruments to such effect, Hammerwood is taking this concept that step further that no one else is doing, his wife insisted what we're doing is really, really. So thank you for your support. Time for refreshments.
Just another thank you for coming all this way on a hot afternoon. It's been
and thank you to Ralitsa, especially.
Yes.
I think she disappeared in case I lost.
She's very good. To all our helpers, you'll notice we've got a wonderful team of international volunteers, and without whom this would not be happening at all. And so you will probably meet them as they're going to be butting. We're offering you a wonderful glass of refreshing Prosecco or rather lovely elderflower cordial. So make your way to the hall, and thank you very much.